Welcome back to the Environmental Law Monitor. I'm your host, Daniel Pope. The Monitor is brought to you by Bracewell LLP's Environmental and Natural Resources Group, and we're glad you decided to spend some time with us. Please connect with us on our website or reach out to us at themonitor@bracewell.com and subscribe. So in a couple of minutes, you're going to hear a conversation I just had with Tim Wilkins on the benefits of environmental compliance audits and why now might be a good time to perform one or several in light of anticipated upticks in federal environmental law enforcement. It's a good conversation, but after recording, I realized I hadn't properly introduced the topic of environmental compliance audits generally. We had some tech issues at the beginning of our recording session, which I totally blame for, you know, being thrown off what little hosting game I might have. And because Tim and I have spent our whole careers practicing in this area, which for me just means a couple of years. Once we got everything sorted out, we just kind of jumped into the details. Anyways, that violates grand directive number two of the podcast, which is that, you know, we want it to be accessible to our listeners, even if you're not well-versed in a particular topic. But thanks to the magic of podcasting, we can fix that. So for the uninitiated, or for those of you who might not have a compliance role in your company, when we say environmental compliance audit or audit, Tim and I are just talking about an effort taken by a company or organization to take an honest look at its own environmental compliance status with the assistance of outside counsel and environmental consultants who can look at a facility's operations with fresh eyes. Think of it like an environmental house call or checkup. Why audit your environmental compliance status? Well, one, so you can have an accurate read on what's going on at a facility. And two, you can also take advantage of different kinds of incentives or benefits that come from an audit process. Those benefits can include, you know, penalty reductions or maybe even immunity. EPA has a set of audit policies, and several states have also enacted statutes or agencies have promulgated policies. So audits can mean slightly different things or require different procedures depending on where you are and what you're doing. But there are a few key features of these audits that are pretty typical across the board. First, audits have to be voluntary generally. So any self-assessment ordered by a court or ordered by an agency doesn't usually count. A company needs to take an initiative to start kicking tires, as it were. Second, you typically have to disclose the violations you discover to the relevant agency to be eligible for audit benefits. So the agency's still getting increased information about your operations and your facility's compliance status, but you're providing that information voluntarily instead of them having to send out inspectors to get that same info. Third, along with your disclosures of any violations you discover, you typically have to propose some kind of corrective action plan or program that will bring your facility back into full compliance with applicable laws. And then, you know, you have to deliver the goods. You actually have to complete that corrective action program. If you've done all these things, you'll typically be eligible for reductions in penalties, if those penalties are even assessed in the first place, or you might actually be immune from enforcement. And again, that's location dependent. Also depends on if you correct those compliance issues you've identified and disclosed as part of a voluntary audit. So that's a quick 101 on environmental audits. I hope that gives you enough of a foothold on what we talk about when we talk about audits. Let me know if that was helpful for making sense of my conversation with Tim, which will roll right about now. Today, I'm joined by Tim Wilkins, a partner in our Austin office. Tim's probably the closest thing I have to a sensei here at the firm. Obviously, I don't call him that in person, but welcome to the podcast, Tim.
Hey, thanks, Daniel.
So we're going to be talking about environmental compliance audits today, which is something I thought I would never necessarily say, at least 3 or 4 years ago when I was in law school. So I don't know if you remember this. I was a summer associate a few years ago. And of course, they don't talk about environmental compliance audits very much at law school. But one of the first things I did as a summer associate was assist on some audits. And I asked if you could wise me up, you could pass anything to me that I could read more about these audits, because, you know, I only heard about those in the IRS context. And lo and behold, you had actually written an article several years ago about environmental compliance audits. You've been doing this for a long time. Tell us just a little bit about how this topic became of interest to you and maybe a couple of the things that you've done over the course of your career to promote environmental compliance audits and to help other people develop a framework for those, in some cases, legislators.
Sure. I mean, environmental compliance auditing has always been of interest to me. I mean, when I was in law school, I was very interested in environmental protection. And as a lawyer, was interested in the idea of counseling clients on how to comply with these really complicated environmental laws. When I was in law school, I had the opportunity to come clerk at the Bracewell firm and to work with a guy by the name of Terrell Hunt, who had been the immediate past head of EPA's Office of Enforcement Policy. And Terrell and I talked a lot about this environmental audits idea. There was a little bit going on in the trade press at the time about environmental audits and how EPA had come after some people and used their internal compliance auditing as evidence against them in enforcement proceedings. And that struck me as sort of wrongheaded. It struck me, though, that environmental compliance auditing would be a really great tool for different companies to use to help with their compliance assurance efforts. You adopt programs and you do your best and you try and make sure your permits are in place and that you're following all the regulatory and permit requirements. But sometimes it's good to have fresh eyes go back and look and make sure that you've been doing everything that you thought you were doing. As part of that conversation with Terrell, we decided to write an article together. In 1992, we published in the Harvard Environmental Law Review an article called Environmental Audits and Enforcement Policy. And it laid out what audits are. It laid out the risks that you undertake by basically looking at your compliance track record and documenting where you have broken the law. I mean, that's obviously potentially good evidence to be used against you in an enforcement proceeding. Talking about the ideas about attorney-client privilege, about other opportunities to not have that stuff become evidence against you. And then threw out the idea of maybe if companies would do voluntary self-audits, find problems, fix those problems, disclose those problems to the agencies, that in a time of scarce inspection resources on the agency's part, maybe there's an opportunity for penalty leniency and we could get into this cycle of people doing the self-policing and getting better and not getting punched in the mouth for violations that they were, out there trying to solve. It's become a big deal. By the mid-90s, 25 states or so had adopted audit privileges or audit disclosure requirements. EPA has a very solid environmental auditing policy that follows the find, fix, and disclose model. By the time we got to the 2000s, I was looking at ways of applying the audit policy, audit disclosure idea in the context of transactions where somebody is a new owner of a company or facilities. Shouldn't there be opportunities for them to go turn over the rocks and make disclosures and fix stuff without being, again, hit in the mouth for violations that weren't even their fault?
Yeah, it's kind of like, I mean, it's like you're all of those things try to solve, I guess what you could call like the ostrich problem, right? Instead of being engaged at a daily or monthly or quarterly rate with my environmental compliance obligations and having that conversation inside a company without any protections whatsoever, the incentive is just to ignore or stick your head in the sand. And so it seems like audits have really leveraged what you're talking about as scarce inspection resources. I almost think about those as always being scarce just because there are so many more members of the regulated community than there are inspectors. And so you're really just dramatically amplifying how many people are paying attention to potential compliance issues.
No, I think that's right. I mean, I think there is a tendency in a lot of companies to say, look, I've got this really robust compliance program. I've hired smart people. Why would I need to do that kind of checkup? I'm doing that checkup all the time. That's why I hired these people. And I think the answer is laws change, equipment breaks, people leave. I mean, compliance isn't a destination, it's a journey, right? The idea that you need to keep after it because it does continue to evolve. It does continue to change. And doing a periodic checkup, especially with some fresh eyes, is a way to make sure that you aren't being complacent about my systems are good enough. This is the way we've done it, and we never got cited before. It's an opportunity to relook. It's an opportunity to avoid stuff that might have fallen through the cracks. And I've got to say, as great an idea as it is generally, I've got to say, as we emerge from the pandemic, where we may not have had as many eyes on, as many boots on the ground from an internal company compliance perspective, I think now's an exceptional opportunity to go out, figure out if stuff did fall through the cracks, and to get ahead of the inspectors who you know are coming. And the pandemic's sort of an excuse, but it's not a complete excuse. Getting your arms around anything that was missed, getting that stuff fixed, and taking advantage of disclosure opportunities to kill off penalties, that to me is a tremendous sales proposition.
And it's kind of for your own EHS employees, it's kind of like getting a rep in or getting back into the gym. The way that I think about these audits is that you're driving a conversation, obviously in connection with legal counsel, obviously in connection with consultants, but it's excellent for EHS personnel to dig back into and to reevaluate, you know, does this particular regulatory program even apply? If so, why? What are the burdens of complying with X, Y, or Z regulations? Instead of that becoming or just devolving, like you said, into tradition or the way that we've always done it here, brings that back into the, you know, the prefrontal cortex or something. You know, it makes people conscious of what environmental compliance obligations there actually are at a particular facility or at a particular operation. And I think that's just good because one of the things that you and I have talked about in connection with audits are also, you know, broader environmental management systems. We've talked about, you know, moving beyond audits and thinking about the culture of a facility, the culture of a company. And so I think that audits really drive that culture. If you think about it, they promote a certain level of engagement with those topics.
Well, look, you've raised a couple of things there that I think are critical. First, I've done thousands, literally thousands of environmental compliance audits, and I've never seen one where everybody involved didn't learn something. That could be learning a wrinkle in the regs. That could be learning something new about the process or the way you operate stuff that forces you to rethink, am I really in compliance? It really is great hygiene around this idea that we need strong lines of communication to have a robust compliance program. Having somebody come in and question you, it's like this thing that, you know, you think you know something until you try and teach it to somebody else. When somebody comes in and sort of walks you through the paces, explain to me again how this works, explain to me how that meets this reg, you learn it better, and you do really pick up on nuances on that. And then as to the point about culture, I mean, building a strong EHS culture to me is critical. I think everybody has seen the issues about safety culture that came out of the BP Texas City report and things like that. Culture really is critical. Complacency about I've got great programs and great people, so I don't need to do anything beyond that is tricky. And building a culture where everybody who's operating, everybody who's responsible for compliance knows that there's going to be a third-party checkup, it helps avoid that sort of complacency. You second-guess yourself because you know you're going to be asked those questions. What is it, every 3 years, every 4 years, every 5 years? I think if you know that's coming, you're going to look at your job in terms of maintaining compliance, in terms of double-checking your work product. I think that's just a culture that you want to imbue within a company.
So picking up on the culture topic and thinking about environmental compliance and the current administration, you know, we've talked a little bit about what's going on at the administration. You know, it seems like when there's a transition, this was certainly my experience. This has been the first administration transition that I've gone through as an attorney. You know, for about 3 months or so, there's a lot to write about. There's a lot to think about. You're looking at new nominees. You're thinking about, what are the odds that this person gets confirmed? Oh, you know, what are going to be the policies? What does this particular pick signify? Right. So there's tons of discussion. There's a lot to write about and a lot to read. And then we're in this sort of like a calm period right now. We've written all we can. We've talked all we can about nominees, about what policies might be. But those new policies haven't shown just yet, at least in a concrete way, right? We're not looking at enforcement guidance or a new enforcement initiative from the administration just yet. I mean, that could be coming in a few months, but we don't have it right now. And you and I have talked about why this in particular, not just because of the pandemic, but because of the change in administration, why this may also be a good time to start an audit if you haven't already. One thing I think we're going to see with this administration is a return to enforcement instead of compliance assistance or compliance assurance. Now, because this is the first administration transition I've lived through, I don't have a ton to offer, but I would love to hear some of your insights, Tim, when you've seen EPA pivot towards a more enforcement priority approach and how audits can help there.
Well, Daniel, I mean, you're right that there has been a change in emphasis between administrations. The previous administration talked about compliance focus as opposed to enforcement and punishment focus. All well and good. The idea that enforcement went away during the previous administration, it didn't. That was half of what I did for the past 4 years. But I will say that there will be an increased emphasis on enforcement, and it's going to be a prioritized emphasis. I think you saw the last administration move away from industry sector priorities and move toward more pollutant priority focus. I suspect this administration will go back to industry segment focused priorities for enforcement. And I think the two phrases that you keep hearing over and over again from the very top of this administration are climate change and environmental justice. Enforcement will look for ways, and this comes from a very strongly worded memo to the regions from Administrator Regan, the new EPA administrator, saying that this stuff's going to be a priority. His memo specifically focused on EJ, but you know that climate is going to be a big part of it. And if climate change is going to be what they're going after with enforcement tools, you know the fossil segment is going to be a target. That's where our CO2, that's where our methane come from. And so if you are anywhere up and down the hydrocarbon value chain, you can expect that there's going to be additional enforcement attention. It is going to be, and again, this is at the margins, but it's going to be more focused on punishment and less focused on compliance. And I think you will find that this coming administration will be looking for wins through the enforcement process where they can say, we count the following beans as reduced climate-related emissions. So there's going to be a lot of focus on injunctive relief, on pollution controls that go beyond what the underlying regulations would require. And again, there's going to be focus on facilities that are located in environmental justice communities. If there are incidents that occur in environmental justice communities, you can be sure that there will be very heavily targeted enforcement on that stuff. What does all that mean for environmental auditing? It means if you have facilities in environmental justice communities that do create exposures for the neighbors, you want to prioritize the auditing to get ahead of enforcement that's going to occur there. If you are in a fossil segment, you have climate change related emissions, you're going to want to focus on your air issues at facilities in that segment and make sure you are as buttoned up as you can be. It's not going to stop enforcement from happening, but you can minimize some of the downsides of enforcement when it does arrive.
And one of the things that you you touched on, but I just want to highlight something that I've realized in my short time in participating in audits is that you get the opportunity to select corrective actions for yourself, right? You conduct an audit, you go through the process of diagnosing your compliance status with respect to whatever programs you have. And then if you do identify a compliance issue, you know, 9 times out of 10, you can take a second and figure out what kind of corrective action works for you or that particular facility or that particular business unit. And I didn't necessarily get the significance of that when I first started assisting you with some of these audits. But then you look at consent decrees, right? And you know, you think about audits like, oh, maybe I'll get some penalty relief, right? But oftentimes in the consent decree context, injunctive relief can be the item that causes the real sticker shock, right? Because it may not have a dollar amount attached to it in the consent decree. And at the same time, that could be, and may in some cases often be, the most expensive and the most onerous aspect of that consent decree.
There's no question.
And so getting the opportunity or claiming the opportunity for yourself to pick something that corrects a problem that you don't have to negotiate over with an agency seems to be a huge potential benefit of conducting an audit, especially when you know that there's about to be a new wave of enforcement that's going to definitely come with some injunctive expectations.
Yeah. If you go in through the audit door, as long as your corrective action results in return to compliance, that's going to be for the agency. And that's not the case when you're already in an enforcement proceeding with an agency. They may insist, and they have settlement leverage to kind of insist that you do something that's more expensive or more difficult or that is constraining to your operations. Mm-hmm. You know, they'll listen to you as part of that negotiation, and hopefully you can talk them out of things that are truly dumb or wasteful ideas. But you certainly lose some of the ability to choose your own adventure when it comes to what you're going to do for compliance methods.
And at that point, you're trapped in that negotiation posture instead of proposing a total package, right? Like this is what we believe applies to us. This is where we think we have some compliance issues, and this is how we're going to come back into compliance. Is just a totally different kind of proposal, and one I think that you know is a huge, huge value for anyone who's conducting these audits. You know, another thing that I'm curious about, Tim, is when companies have a culture of managing their environmental systems of auditing, what does that do for a facility or a company's relationship with the regulated or with the regulatory agencies, right? With TCEQ, with EPA, and this is genuinely a question. I don't have anything necessarily that I'm expecting you to say, but I was wondering, you know, if a company has a strong EMS or a strong compliance auditing program, and they are in regular conversations with agency officials, does that enhance the relationship in appreciable ways? Is that in and of itself a benefit so that you kind of move from just being a number, an EPA ID, a regulated entity number, into being a company that has a connection with these agencies?
You know, I think that does happen. I don't think it's a huge factor. Like if you get caught by an inspector doing something wrong at one of your facilities, it's not going to save you from enforcement that you've got some prior conversation going on. But I think that if you are a company that is in regular dialogue with the agencies about, hey, we've been self-auditing and we found these issues. We wanted to be sure you knew. We wanted to be sure that you knew we were addressing it. If you are someone who takes advantage of, for example, the Texas Audit Privilege Act and makes disclosures under that, or even just, you know, has periodic dialogue with the regulators, I think that it does create at least some feeling that there's good faith and transparency, which goes a long way. I've talked to friends who are former regulators who come out into the private sector, and they'll have an impression of a company. You know, those people lie, cheat, and steal. And, you know, that's just an impression that they get based on what they see as regulators. They may have seen bad conduct. They may have seen bad behavior. And if they don't get a countervailing view of the company through that kind of dialogue, here's what we're doing, here's how we're trying to make this work right, we care about this stuff. If that dialogue doesn't exist, the negative presumptions can survive and thrive within the agency. So I think it is worth engagement. And I think audits, especially like at the TCEQ, I'm not sure that e-disclosures at EPA particularly create that sort of dialogue or engagement. By engaging in that way through the audit process, I think you do help create pathways for understanding that puts you in a better position rather than a worse position when something does actually go wrong.
That especially makes sense when so many federal programs are administered by state agencies like the TCEQ as well, right?
Okay.
Well, so this has been a fascinating conversation, which I didn't really think I would ever say about environmental compliance audits, but they really have been an interesting thing to get to learn. You know, environmental law professors don't lead off on day one talking about environmental compliance audits. I don't think I ever heard a law professor mention auditing as a topic. I mean, I guess except for the federal income tax professors who I ran away from in the hallways. So it's been really an interesting area of my practice that I've gotten to develop a little bit and to see how practical and real it is for clients and for companies. Before I let you go though, you know, one of the things that we've been doing to humanize some of the people that work at the firm has been to ask, you know, sort of a light item question. And aside from the vaccine, you know, what are you hoping to take out of this pandemic experience?
I mean, it's so dumb, but the various video conferencing platforms have changed my life. Just the ability to see somebody's face while you're talking with them about these issues, especially with new clients who you haven't met before, people who call because they've gotten into trouble, they are referred to you. When you have the ability at the drop of a hat to get on a video chat with somebody instead of saying, yeah, I mean, I can visit you, it'll be 6 or 7 days before I can get there. But I think this opportunity to just do face-to-face without having to do travel is something I will take more advantage of. I will pick up the video call instead of a phone call, 75% of the time. It's a great little tool.
It's so weird to email or dialogue with somebody for years and not actually know what their face looks like. and so all of that has solved that problem. And it's been fun to see, you know, how people react visually to the things that you're saying. It's been really neat to do. And I hope that we keep up with that as well. Well, thank you for coming on the Environmental Law Monitor, Tim. And thank you all for listening. Be sure to stay tuned, subscribe, and we'll talk to you soon.